Hello my fellow Archons, and welcome to Day 2 of KeyForge Christmas. In today's video, we ask the question, is this 74 sass called the Archons deck the fastest deck out there? With this exorbitant expected Ember stat of 47, the only deck on DOK with an E rating that high, you'd probably think it is. I played 10 games in the competitive queue of TCO to test this deck, become familiar with it, and see how it really plays to give you guys the ultimate analysis. Without further ado, let's get into it. So make no mistake, this deck is pure burst. The Untamed has double Hunting Witch and triple Dust Pixie with a key charge to cap it all off. There's also double Regrowth to get those creatures back if necessary, and a couple more pips with Nocturnal Maneuver and Vigor. In the Shadows, we actually have a pretty decent amount of Ember control with double Routine Job, double Nerve Blast, Miasma, Bait and Switch, and a Dodger. There's also double Silvertooth, which almost act as Ember pips on their own since they interplay ready and you can reap with them immediately. And the Ghostly Hand is a bursty card as well. Then in Sanctum, we have more raw Ember pips packed onto a single card with Virtuous Works, and burst apart from pips in the form of double Glorious Few. With only 12 creatures in the deck, I found some pretty consistent value out of these, usually netting 4 or more Ember at a time. There's also double Terms of Redress, Raiding Knight, and Champion Tabris for some more Ember control, and double Blinding Light for some board control. It's a very simple and easy deck to pilot. Play cards and get Ember is pretty much the deck's whole game plan. It even has the ability to stop keys with that solid Shadows House and the capture available in Sanctum. I found myself checking at 6 or more Ember at least every other turn. My opponents almost always had to have some form of Ember control at their disposal, otherwise I was forging. After 10 games in competitive on TCO, I ended with a 7-3 record. Game 1, I took a single glance at the opponent's decklist and saw 3 Infernaces. Oh no. And there's also an Effervescent Principle in Logos. However, my burst was so overwhelmingly fast that not even 3 Infernaces and an EP could stop me. Granted, his Infernaces did come out a little awkwardly, though he still hit my Virtuous Works and a few other nice cards of mine, but it just didn't matter. Cards like Glorious Few hit for tons of Ember, and that's not a card Infernace can use to take Ember from you. It's burst that doesn't rely on vulnerable pips. I soundly defeated this 86 sass MM deck and moved on to Game 2. Game 2 was against an 82 sass Woe deck. This time, I saw 2 Rant and Rives in the Brobnar House and felt I'd run into a bad matchup. I realized the importance of Key Charge, hopefully not giving them the opportunity to use their R&Rs on me. Their triple Mars Needs Ember were cancer to deal with as well, since there was double Tixel Beambuckler to complement them, damage pips in the Mars, and a puzzling trinket to use Ember as damage on top of that. They got some pretty good use out of them. However, my deck generated Ember so quickly that I was able to force out the Rant and Rives early and threaten check virtually every turn, requiring them to make use of their Ember control at every opportunity. Even that wasn't enough. I was able to stop their keys a few times and eventually got the win. We played a rematch after that, which I won as well, putting my record at 3-0. The sheer speed of my deck was crazy to see. My ability to recur Dust Pixies and Hunting Witches with the regrowths made my key charge almost a guaranteed key whenever it showed up in my hand every game. The Ember output of cards like Ghostly Hand, Virtuous Works, and Glorious Few, in addition to stealing the opponent's Ember, getting instant reaps with the Silvertooth, and playing my other raw pips was just a constant oppressive force the opponent could rarely keep up with. My game 4 opponent had even less Ember control than my previous two, though their closed door negotiation certainly had me concerned. That card would come back to haunt me later. I was 4-0. Game 5 is where I took my first loss, and I realized the problem of board control. My deck doesn't really have that much of it. Blinding Light, Save the Pack, Nerve Blast, and Nocturnal Maneuver were the only real tools I had to work with, and with only 12 small creatures in the deck, I wasn't doing much fighting. I was up against a Winds of Exchange deck that generated tons of the Thieving Trader tokens, and had an extremely capture-heavy Sanctum along with some solid stuff in the Equidon. I was generating Ember like crazy. As you can see, I ended the game with 17 Ember checking for my third key, with an additional 6 on enemy lines, but I just couldn't do much about that captured Ember, or deal with their traders at the same rate as they were generating them. I utilized my Blinding Lights and Routine Jobs the best I could, but my Glorious Fuse came too late, and he also blasted me with a devastating closer negotiation, stealing 13 of my Ember all at once. I took the L. Game 6 was an easy win. The opponent had very little Ember control and too many dud cards like Triple Revered Monk. The Unfathomable was pretty scary though, with double Abyssal Sight and double Befuddle. He befuddled me into an awkward situation a couple times, but I just had so many burst options at my disposal that his Abyssal Sights weren't effective enough. I was 5-1. Game 7, I ran into the card that shut down my deck completely, the hardest possible counter, Aether Spider. He got his Aether Spider out early, completely nullifying any burst I did, and soon got it not only under taunt, but also extra armor. My only hope was Save the Pack, which I set up for with a Nerve Blast, but he had a Hollowed Blaster he healed his Spider with right before I was about to play it. The game was completely over at that point. As you can see, I racked up 22 Ember onto this Flame Wreath, taunted, armored Aether Spider, and this screenshot was taken about 2/3 of the way through the game. and even if I did find a way to kill the spider, he had Doorstep to Heaven in reserve to delete all my Ember anyway. I conceded, we rematched, and this time I took W, since his Aether spider came out much later and I was able to burst properly. I was 6-2. Game 9, I ran into a Coda deck that actually used to belong to me, that I sold recently. A triple control the weak deck with good board control, decent library access potential, and an epic quest that my opponent said he had been able to pull off 15 or so times since owning the deck, which is way more consistency than I was ever able to find with it. It was a tight match. Sure enough, my opponent forged with epic quest this game, but it was too little too late, and I got the W. Then I made the mistake of rematching. The three control the weaks came out in full force, constraining me to houses that I couldn't take optimal or bursty turns with, and his library access turn gave him a big lead. Then he pulled off epic quest a second time to seal the deal and forge his third key for free. If only my epic quest had any hope of firing like that. And so, my ending record was 7-3. So one of this deck's biggest weaknesses seems to be Aether Spider, but that stems from a lack of board control overall, and we saw that problem rise against very capture-heavy decks as well, and that one also had Traitor spam to boot. It also struggles against decks that can consistently force suboptimal turns and have ways to forge keys for free, and I'm sure TMTP and Graft would pose big threats as well, though I was lucky enough to not run into either of them. But I've found that the sheer speed of this deck can steamroll over even such walls as Triple Infernus and Double Rat and Rive. It's just so fast that it doesn't care about losing that Ember. Its main problem seems to be a result of lacking board control. The Ember control is substantial enough to keep the opponent from forging here and there, and give you just enough to burst ahead and win. Overall though, Odin Jackson is a real menace of a deck, the epitome of classic Coda Burst. If someone asked you to define what Coda Burst meant, you could show them a picture of this deck and they would understand perfectly, maybe just throw in a Nature's Call or something. Rarely did I ever have what felt like a bad hand. The worst hand I ever had was something like Seeker Needle, Tabarus, Raiding Knight, and Save the Pack with a couple other cards. My hand almost always provided me with a way to reach check, which is why those control weaks hurt me so much. It's a super fun deck that punches way above its SAS rating that requires little to no skill to pilot. No complicated combos, no archiving cards for later, just turn your brain off and forge keys. And there we have it. Let me know what you guys think of this deck in the comments below, or if you have a deck that you think is faster, that you think is deserving of the title of the deck with the highest ESAT on DOK. Now that I've analyzed the highest SAS deck in the world, and the one that supposedly generates the most Ember, I may have to explore the other side of the coin and analyze something a little less crazy. But that does it for day 2 of KeyForge Christmas. Day 3 is right around the corner. Thank you all so much for watching, and I can't wait to see you all again in the next one. See you later.